भानु तेजा चिट्टी बाबू गिरीश सिंगाई हेलो सर गिरीश जी जाहिर हुसैन दादा साहेब देशमुख अजय यादव उपस्वामी आर्यन श्रीकांत राव भरत समय नागराजु मतंगी सुब्रमण्यम आवला प्रकाश भूरे शुभोदय रवितेज हाय रवितेज हाउ आर यू सुब्रमण्यम सीवीएस रमेश गीता वेलकम यू ऑल गौतम चौरसिया अनदर टू मिनट्स राघवेंद्र I don't know. Sometimes I don't get the screen share. Okay. Arkam, Ajam, Veer Raghavan, Elumalai. मुकेश हेमंत रेड्डी गारु गुड मॉर्निंग सदानंदम हाय प्रशांत चितार भास्करन हाय दुर्गा प्रसाद वेलकम विनीत कुमार वंशी हाय काश्यप गुड मॉर्निंग मुकेश शिवतेजा गुड मॉर्निंग टू यू ऑल टुडे इज द मोस्ट अनदर मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक वाटर मैनेजिंग द वाटर It's a very important subject for every civil engineer, actually. If I had not become a structural engineer, probably I would have become a hydrology and water resource man. I first joined M.Tech in hydrology, then got promoted to structures. Because that's the importance I give to water, actually, as a civil engineer. So stormwater discharge which we deal with actually as civil engineers in planning the levels planning the drains and water conservation which is gaining more and more importance nowadays because of the water shortage and then managing the flood so these are the three important topics as regards to water in the current day scenario. So my overview of the topic is I'll cover about introduction to the water and water conservation, stormwater discharge, and some of the project case studies that we have done in stormwater discharge and conservation and flooding. So these are all important topics, though it looks small, It is a huge topic actually, and there is a lot of scope. So water and under echo, echo is in the Bhaskar?
Less sir.
Okay, okay. Now it should be okay anyway. I have controlled. So water and awareness, every engineer, every citizen of the world should be having awareness about usage of water. And storm water is one of the important subjects that is handled by civil engineers. Watershed management is a huge subject for economists actually. And groundwater again is a civil engineer subject. Catchment again is civil engineer subject. And the river management and river training is again civil engineers handle. Conservation is a part of green building norms and all, but we handle it. Flooding again, civil engineers have to handle the flooding. So today I'll be covering all these aspects in this topic. So many people say water, excess water going into the sea is undesirable or it's a waste. It's a big point of debate actually. There is a argument that excess water from the ground, because that's how it used to be when world population is only 1 billion, let us say. There was always so much of excess water. Irrigation is less and only forests were there. Rivers were going into the sea only and oceans, sea and oceans. And people argue the salinity of the ocean will increase if the river waters won't go. So there is a good research, it's a good research topic for civil engineers to study what is the total water in the ocean and what is the percentage of contribution from the rivers. But definitely it is whatever by evaporation the seawater goes and increases the concentration of the salinity. So we have to, it's a huge subject for study, how much water rivers are contributing to the ocean in percentage and how much salinity it will increase. So this is one good subject for research. And next is the population. World population now is 7 billion and it is growing for, more and more. So water shortage is not due to nature actually. Water shortage is due to increased consumption because population is growing. And so the need of conserving the water, managing the water, and managing the flood also. Flood also is caused by increasing population, you know. We are covering more natural ground, so we are preventing percolation, and so the floods are increasing in the urban areas. Agriculture and irrigation, the demand for water is there in so many ways actually. We need agriculture with the growing population, we need more agriculture, and so more irrigation, so more irrigated land is required, which is happening. And home needs, of course, water per capita consumption is home needs. And industrial and power, so with the growth in population and growth in technology, more industries and so more power requirement. Even for power generation, we need water. And even people say solar needs less water. No, because solar panels needs to be maintained with water also. And recreation and hospitality, recreation, we need water, hospitality, hotels, office buildings need water, and hospitals need water. So there is a need with growing population every year at a CAGR of 4 to 5% growth in population. We need to devise alternative methods of farming, alternative methods of home needs and conserving methods and all that. And we can take cue from Israel. Israel, the land that you can irrigate or do farming was only 5%. And there are no rains. Rainfall is very less, like 100 mm, 200 mm kind of rainfall. And you must visit Israel to get motivated, you know. People have started farming without rains, without water, without even soil. So the technology, and the research on consumption and alternative methods is a huge scope for civil engineers. So it can lead to good research in civil engineering. Not always fly ash, blending of concrete, that is nothing actually compared to research in water if civil engineers can come up with. So stormwater, when we talk about stormwater, why we knew, as civil engineers, we should know about stormwater. It is because we design buildings, we have roof terraces, and we have to manage the stormwater. And we do buildings means industrial buildings, we do office buildings, every building has a terrace. And every building has to collect this stormwater. And we have to drain this stormwater, we have to drain this stormwater. And next we design roads. Roads also we provide camber only for drainage. And we design landscape, leveling of the land. So we have to, any open land, we have to, suppose we are designing a project in 10 acres, 10 acres will have rainfall. And 10 acres will have its catchment, the water. And we have to design that collection of water and drainage of water. And the fields, outside, farm, fields and all that. And then we have to design the drains. There are through drains it goes into the nalas, through nalas it goes into the tanks and then reservoirs and lakes. And finally lakes overflow into river and river overflow into the sea. So this is the stormwater flow cycle actually. So as civil engineers we should understand the flow of water actually. That's very important and how we manage this water without water getting contaminated. So we have to see that the water is water contamination is minimized. So this is the about stormwater. And then what is water conservation? Water conservation nowadays is very essential, as I said, because we have to the population is growing, the need for water is growing, but water available is constant, you know. So we have to see that water consumption is minimized, water wastage is minimized, and rainwater is collected and stored. And because we don't have time for natural cycle like olden days. Olden days, water used to percolate through the ground and go into the groundwater and come into the tanks. People used to have tanks or rivers only. Olden days, people used to collect water from tanks and river. Then came open wells, then came bore wells, then came now pumping from the rivers. So we are exceedingly using energy and power for getting water, which otherwise used to be natural, olden days. So now we have to go back to those techniques of using the water, which I'll be sharing today about the conservation techniques and groundwater retention. Harvesting, rainwater harvesting, recycling of the water to reduce the wastage of water, and monsoons. We have to study the monsoon patterns and then use the water from the rains, and then house water conservation at different levels, like a house. In your own house, you can conserve the water. That means collect the water and store the water so that you are self-reliant. You don't have to depend on outside thing. This is going to be future. Like people are telling now, collect oxygen cylinder and keep it at your home. We are reaching that stage now. Air, water, everybody has to depend on their own means and sources actually. So it's very important. House level conservation, community level. That means if you have apartment, you should have a, even if your existing apartment doesn't have this, retrofitting of the apartments for water conservation and water recycling, water waste management is a big subject for civil engineering. We can go and offer solutions to these communities actually. Next level is the colony. A colony of 100 communities, let us say. We have to have a planning colony level, I always say. Environmental neutralization. That means minimize the wastage and collect the water and recycle the water. Region next. That means if we have a Hyderabad, we have regions in Hyderabad which we can target and plan this water conservation. Zone, south zone, north zone, west zone, then is the city actually, overall city. Imagine if civil engineers can take up this as an assignment and go and offer services. Imagine what kind of change we can bring to the city. So this we have done it. We tried, we attempted actually doing this. Next is the flooding. Why flooding happens in any city? Like Chennai, we had floods in 2016. Yeah, 2016 December. There was huge floods. And in Hyderabad, we have floods in 2000, in 1920. Every time we have floods in 1908, I think. Yeah, Hyderabad. Huge flood. When Mokshakunda Visvesaraya had given flood mitigation plan, flood hazard mitigation plan to the Hyderabad city by identifying 2000 lakes and protecting those lakes. And now what we are doing? We are encroaching into those lakes. We are filling those lakes. And so when you build your houses in full tank level, FTL, definitely you will be flooded because you are encroaching into the water. Water is not encroaching into your living areas actually. And study the topo maps as engineers. We have to study, plan so that there is no flooding in the habitation areas. And we have used the Google Maps to study this. And always water requirement versus rainfall. Is it sustainable? I just gave some number crunching. Like this is my thought always. You have Hyderabad city, 600 square kilometers. Hyderabad city area is 600 square kilometers. And Hyderabad average minimum rainfall is 1000 mm, I can say. That means 1 meter rainfall, sorry. And the population of Hyderabad is 9 million people actually. So now if you multiply this 600 square kilometers with 1 meter, the water that you get through rainfall to Hyderabad city is 600 into 10 to the power of 6 cubic meters. That is the water we are getting. So let us see the computation of water consumption per capita. I am taking average 200 liters per capita. That means 0.2 cubic meters. So 365 days into 0.2 cubic meters, you have 73 cubic meters per capita water consumption. And 9 million people, 9 into 10 to the power of 6. So the total is 657 into 10 to the power of 6 cubic meters. See, through rain itself, we are getting 600. But where is this water going? Why we are pumping water 300 million gallons per day? 300 million gallons per day Hyderabad is getting from Krishna phase 1, phase 2, phase 3 and Godavari, Hyderabad. I'm only just taking example of Hyderabad because I have these numbers, but the same is the situation with every city. So we have lot of scope for civil engineers to work on this water requirements of every city. Every student, every civil engineer, students can do like summer internship or projects to study why this shortfall of water, why Hyderabad is spending so much on pumping of water and treatment of water. Can we minimize this, if not eliminate? So this is the topic actually. I made students in 2017 do a project, which I'll be sharing that project report actually. The causes of flooding and how it can be eliminated. And so this is the just an example, every food for thought for every civil engineer to think whether we really need to get water from rivers for drinking in the city. So this is the subject actually, because what happened in Hyderabad, let us see. There used to be a Musi River. So we have blocked water into the Musi River. And then we have started pumping from the Usman Sagar and Himayat Sagar lakes. And then we were using that water that was not adequate. Then we have gone to Manjira. Then that was also not adequate. Then we have gone to Krishna. Meanwhile, we were also using groundwater. And groundwater also we have exhausted. I'll share the groundwater contour of Hyderabad. So like that, we are exhausting every natural resource and we are using energy which is not sustainable actually. So this is the food for thought for everyone. So let us look at watershed. what is this watershed? See, this is a natural landscape, you know, before all these cities formed and all. So there is a watershed. If you take this area, watershed area, so there is a rainfall and you have the greenery, and we have the percolation from the greenery, and this is the runoff of excess water after percolation, which comes into this lake, and groundwater aquifers are charged with this lake. So this is the, and we have watershed management to minimize the flood. This is what I said economists will do. You have snow regions, and we have precipitation and rainfall. So this is just to understand the water cycle. Then we have river basins. You know, after this forest, the river catchment basins, you will get the water into the rivers. And this is just an example I have taken. Beautifully, the natural ground, if you study these contours, it will form like leaves, you know, collecting the water into the rivers. And this is the Ganga River basin. It's so it is very important for us to understand these river basins. Way back in 1850 around, Sir Arthur Cotton has prepared the river basin map of India, actually. So for us to understand the water source and water flow, we have to have the idea of these river basins. And this is the geographical profile of Musi River, Hyderabad city, for example. Can anybody imagine Musi River start to end? The slope is 100 meters. So this is the 100 meter fall in the thing, and this is 100 meters level difference. This start to finish, ORR to ORR, let us say. And the fall in the river per every kilometer, this is about 40 kilometers actually. So the fall in the river is 2.5 meters per kilometer. So this is, for us, it is important to understand all this, because when we plan the water, storm water discharge or water conservation, we have to understand all these parameters. And this is the groundwater contour of Hyderabad. Like this, we can collect the data for every city actually. You can see, this is the core of the city. It is in red actually. So the groundwater is going down and down. This is the main city around the Musi River area. You can see groundwater has gone down very badly. And these are all the lakes, 3,000 lakes of Hyderabad. This is a real map. All these blue dots are all supposed to be tanks, lakes. And this is the river of Hyderabad. This is a beautiful natural phenomenon actually, which we are destroying. Out of 190 notified big lakes, now we are left with 90 only. And out of these 3,000 lakes, you can imagine how many are left, how many you can identify. So this is the biggest challenge actually, why we are not having water. So we should allow the natural water to be collected into these lakes. And we should use this natural water instead of pumping from rivers to all the way 200 kilometers and pump up to 200 meters above thing and lift the water. Sorry. Lakes in Hyderabad. This is the water bodies identified, notified water bodies actually. And you can see this is all the urban sprawl. So we have filled all the natural greenery and all and made a city now. So we have we are filthing every day the city river. Musi, this is the photograph of Musi River, you know, how we are dumping the garbage and how we are leaving the sewage into these rivers. Such a beautiful water. People used to drink water from the river directly, which used to have minerals and all. Now we are buying mineral water. We are destroying the minerals in the river, and then we are buying mineral water. This is what is happening. This is the Hussain Sagar Lake, which was supposed to be a drinking water lake actually. It's a beautifully planned 100 years back by those days rulers. And now we are destroyed. We are destroying everything. And again, we started cleaning the lakes actually. So this is because of lack of awareness. And we, the professionals, civil engineers, should keep advising these communities about the water management, actually. So this is the another map of Musi River, how we are encroaching onto this river, actually. If we are studying on this, we are working on a proposal to improve this river look and river conservation, actually. So this is the Musi riverfront mapping. If you see, the river has shrunk to almost 1/4 of its original size, actually. So some people have encroached, some people formed slums, and some we are dumping the garbage. So this is the state of this river Musi. Like this, every river, like Ahmedabad, we have Sabarmati, Delhi, we have Yamuna, and Calcutta, we have Ganga, Patna, we have Ganga. Like that, every city has got some rivers, or it formed on the rivers. So now let us go to this conservation. Our ancient religious texts and epics give a good insight into the water storage and conservation. We forgot these texts, epics and texts, and then we started destroying this. So over the years, rising population, growing industrialization, and expanding agriculture have pushed up the demand for water. That we are all aware. And efforts have been made to collect water by building dams and reservoirs and digging wells. And some countries have also tried to recycle and desalinate the water. That is happening already. In India also, now desalination plants are there. And water conservation has become need of the day. The idea of groundwater recharging by harvesting. So people believed that forests were the mothers of rivers and worshipped the sources of these water bodies. And now we are destroying the forest, which is the source of water, actually, good water. And the importance of conservation is, as we all know, the about 2% of Earth's fresh water is locked in glaciers, you know, and ice caps. And even glaciers are now melting because of this temperature rise. And 97% of water available on Earth is saline, actually. And then, therefore, only 1% of water on Earth is available for drinking. So this is the biggest challenge, and we have to conserve this. That is the importance of conservation, actually. So the conservation involves refraining from water pollution. And it is important because currently only about 10% of Earth's wastewater is disposed. That means other wastewater is going into the soil, and we are spoiling the groundwater. So water conservation saves money, minimizes the effects, or it actually enhances the sustainability of civilizations, actually. We all know about Indus civilization has vanished because the Indus River has changed its course. Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, because of this changes in the monsoon pattern. So sustainability is very important, and we as a civilization, we have to conserve the water so that the future generations have an adequate water supply. We are responsible for our future generation. And strategies used in water conservation include reducing wastage, preventing damage of water quality, and then improving practices of water management. So this is all to be done by civil engineers. And household water conservation initiatives, such as the use of low flush toilet, rainwater harvesting, and use of low flow taps are recommended. Water recycling, so low flow shower heads, low flush toilets, dual flush toilets, that means half flush and full flush, it is very important. And faucet aerators, that means to reduce the water usage through faucet, and then wetting effectiveness and while using less water. And raw water flushing, that means why to use treated water for flushing? So we must have recycled water for flushing. Grey water flushing also should be done. And wastewater reuse or recycling systems allowing reuse of grey water and recycling of wastewater through purification at water treatment plants. So we have primary treatment, tertiary, secondary treatment. In fact, secondary treatment, cycling of the water for flushing and landscape. And we have rainwater harvesting, and high efficiency close washers, that means with less water, so that we have to reduce the per capita consumption of the water. And weather-based irrigation controllers, which is used in Israel, it is not something theoretical. And garden hose nozzles that shut off water when it is not being used, and instead of letting a hose run, that means intelligent watering of these landscapes. Low flow taps in wash basins. Swimming pool covers that reduce evaporation and can warm pool water to reduce the water, energy and chemical cost. And automatic faucets for WC, water closets actually. That is also important. This is already available, automatic faucets. That means when we use water only, it will be there through the faucet. And it can be used without use of hands. So waterless urinals, waterless car washes, and infrared or foot operated taps, which can save water by using short bursts of water. That means when you are using arms, if you use the foot operated tap, then you will get the water only when it is required, and it comes with the pressure so that you don't waste water. And water for rinsing in kitchen and bathrooms primarily, and pressurized water booms, which can be used instead of hose to clean sidewalks. That means cleaning of the sidewalks in the roads and all, you can have these pressurized water booms. And X-ray film processor, recirculation systems, cooling water tower, conductivity controllers, and then water saving steam sterilizers for use in hospitals and healthcare facilities, rainwater harvesting, and water to water heat exchangers. So these are all the different things. So finally, what are all the water saving techniques? That is garden hose nozzles, nozzles, and then fix water water leaks in the taps, and install efficient toilets, and take shorter showers, and then wash full loads. That means in the washing machine, this is what normal people can do this to save water. And engineers can contribute by designing those things. So technical methods, rainwater harvesting, utilization of rainwater, as I have shown calculation, if every house plans the water collection and storage, at least 1 month to 2 months water you need not get from the outside source. So you can use the rainwater that comes from the rains. That means collect the water from the terrace and then store it and then use it. So you should have the storage facility, that's it. Normally we design 15 days storage in the communities for rainwater collection and storage. 15 days water requirement storage we design. Otherwise, normally we do 2 days storage in Hyderabad. In fact, Hyderabad requires 4 days storage because it's alternate days supply. And recharging of borewells near the house, and recharging of groundwater sources, and collection of rainwater reuse actually. So this is the third point is most important for the communities. So as a consultant, you can do a hostile bid. You do the study of a particular colony and go and offer a service to retrofit so that the people don't have water. But definitely the days will come, people will buy water at 100 rupees per liter. So if we are so careless and reckless, and if we continue to be like that. And then recharging of the borewells. So we have to design this water harvesting around the borewell. So dig the borewell up to at least 10 feet dia, and then 10 feet depth, and then create this so that the water percolates into the borewell and you get the better water. And drain all your stormwater after storage, conservation storage, then you convert into harvesting actually. Next is the indirect charging. You can also create this harvesting pit near to the borewell, if not around the borewell. If already borewell is existing, you can create this to charge the borewell near the house. Next is the recharging of the groundwater source, evaporation and evapotranspiration, and then transpiration from the trees. We have to minimize this, and excess water after ground water recharge, it will have runoff. So this we should understand the phenomenon to design the stormwater. what is the discharge we have to design for. And rainwater harvesting system. So this is the collection of rainwater for reuse. You can see we have this downtake pipes and gutter, and from the roof we collect the water and then we collect into the storage tank, groundwater storage tank, and you pump it and then we store it and reuse it. So this is the system we are using. And normal other source of water is pumping here. So this is the typical diagram of water usage. And then we have the rainwater harvesting pits. Like you have the, suppose we are having the watering of the lawns. So you should have the recollection mechanism and get it back to, so we are artificially creating which otherwise erstwhile natural recycling systems were there. And this is a assorted water harvesting system which we designed in the planning layout itself so that water can be collected through so many sources, through roof garden and through this ground, natural ground landscapes actually. And water harvesting through traffic, now we are, it is very popular in the colleges, and this one, we have these percolation roads, permeable roads actually, pavement, permeable pavement, and permeable parking and permeable walkways. So these are all the water harvesting parkings. Like you can design this. Nowadays it is very common. So as civil engineers, we should design this at least 50% open percolation area in the paved areas. And then street runoff, harvesting street runoff. So we have this water collection from the street runoff, and then store it to the, take it to the harvesting pits. And grey water harvesting, even the recycled water which we use for landscape watering of the gardens, we can collect that and then harvest that. And percolation, rainwater, rainfall seeps into the underground through a process called percolation, and where the rainwater travels downwards, tiny spaces, and then collects into the ground. And it will replenish the underground water. So this is the typical rainwater cycle we all know, and we have infiltration, percolation, and water table, and then surface runoff we have, which collects into the rivers, and we have evaporation, transpiration, and precipitation. So this is, of course, we studied in schools, but it is better to refresh when we plan and design these things. So this is another cycle of water in plains actually. So we have evapotranspiration, we have the storage and precipitation and interception of the precipitation and direct use for the forest. Now we are coming into the our subject, like stormwater drainage systems. So how do we collect the water? So we form these stormwater drains, and we have the filters, the intermittent filters and connection to the recharge wells. And then we have the baffle walls to collect the silt actually. And so this is the typical design of a stormwater drain. So stormwater is rainwater, as we all know. And then also melted snow that runs off the streets, lawns, and other sites. So we have to design these stormwater systems for some percentage to be absorbed and the excess water to be collected and directed to the harvesting pits and conservation tanks, harvesting pits, and then excess to overflow storm water. So we have to minimize this storm water drainage. So runoff is like this. As we all know, we have the greenery and we put the drains for storm water. I am covering the runoff calculations as we move forward in the stormwater design. You can see there are four methods of stormwater runoff calculations actually. So why stormwater runoff is a problem? We all know if there is more water, there can be erosion in the soil. In turn, it will reduces the stormwater runoff and then it will cause the flooding. So effects of poor stormwater management is downstream flooding, because there will be a lot of silt collected, turbidity into the water, and then water cannot flow. It requires more slope to flow, and then the flooding happens like this. and then stream bank erosion because of this excess storm water, and then increased turbidity from erosion. You know, if we have this is the continental shelf, loose sediment and slope instability, and a sediment, and then sediment deposits into the river, and finally the rivers will be causing flooding also. So habitat destruction. So this is the like typical deforestation that happens, and then the soil erosion starts, and then the turbidity in the rivers increases, and we all know the effects of this turbidity in the river, flooding. So next is the dry weather. We have to design these underground stormwater lines, and then collection of the stormwater. And 1 minute, this is obstruction. So this is the design of stormwater drains. We have the downspouts, we have the stormwater drain from the surface, and then we collect into the river, or we also have the design for collection of this water depending on the quality of the water. And excess stormwater will also cause the damage to the infrastructure due to the contamination in the excess water. And then we have rivers contaminated because of this excess stormwater flowing over the ground, which it is not supposed to. So if we have to drain this stormwater, so this is a clean water you can see, and this is a contaminated water, how it looks. And concern for two main reasons related to volume and timing of runoff water. And so the flood control and water supplies get affected, and related to potential contaminant that water is carrying, so that it will even contaminate the groundwater. So advantages are provides proper drainage and provides possibility of research. Just a minute, 1 minute. Bhaskar, can you mute me? Sorry for interruption because of some important call. So now Bhaskar, yeah. So provides proper drainage and surface runoff, provides a possibility to recharge and minimizing the health risk. Sorry. So effective stormwater flood control and can be integrated into urban landscape, and revenue generated by stormwater utility can be used as a new dedicated source of funds for to supplement. There are some funds actually for water management. So the challenges are, you require expert planning. So we are experts, and the implementation, operation and maintenance required for stormwater management, and it depends on the technique, lot of operation and labor required for this, but still it is worth, because it is this only is sustainable. And temporary covering methods such as plastic sheeting can become torn or ripped and exposing the contaminant and precipitation. So examples of sustainable stormwater management is it incorporates the natural environment and engineered systems, promotes sustainable stormwater management principles. Green roofs, rain gardens, and porous pavements, green infrastructure at the scale of neighborhood or site. I'll run a bit faster. And rain gardens. So these are called the rain gardens, where we create the soil and there will be impervious layer. And so the water collected will be retained in the soil, and then the rain gardens will be there. And this is another home rain garden that is without much of treatment, but still we create the soil for plants and farming. And bioretention areas, also I'll show the pictures. So these are bioretention areas where we retain the water, and this is the bioretention, it is called. So under drain pipes we create and then collect the water into this, and then still maintain this bioretention areas. And vegetated swales. So this is the vegetated swales. Instead of designing the stormwater with lining and all, we have this lawn and clay created so that it looks green always, and but still act as a drain. So this is the picture of that vegetated swale. And then we have the system of roofing, green roofs. And so this is the green roof. Nowadays it has become very popular. People are farming vegetables and fruits and flowers on the terraces. This is very important. We all know it has the advantage of utilizing your roof to do the farming, because we are building houses on the green land. So at least again you create greenery on your roof. Compensation, and then collect the water for roof garden and use it. So these are the pictures of roof gardens, which are quite common nowadays in the cities, and we have to encourage this. That means why I am telling all this to engineers is, as engineers we should encourage people to have these roof gardens. And porous pavements. So this is the porous pavement. We have to design this porous pavement. It's not just that you replace your pavers with porous pavers, but you should have for excess water, because again, water is enemy to the soil. We all know there will be settlements happening if you allow the water percolation below the pavement. So it requires proper design. And a stream buffer restoration. So this is the three types of buffer zones, and fast growing trees and shrubs. And then we have native grass. And this is the final overflow here, because the trees can use the water that is available here. So these are some of the projects that I'll share the examples where we have contributed. Proposal of drains, time of concentration calculations, and then we have this intensity of rainfall, which is very important, which we'll collect from the thing. And these are the different models developed by, this is a research paper actually from IISc, which we have collected this data, and we use it for so runoff coefficients, which is very important. Somebody was asking, how do you calculate the stormwater runoff? So we have to know these average values considered for runoff. Like we have watertight roof surfaces, we have bituminous pavement, we have the concrete pavement. For this, these are the runoff coefficient, and the average runoff coefficient here is 0.85, you can see. And then we have waterbound macadam and heavy clay soils. So we have to design the driveways depending on these coefficients, what we want. We want water absorption or we want water runoff. And but turfed and sandy clays and all, here we don't consider the coefficient at all as runoff. So total, so this is a project which I'm sharing in the airfield, and we calculated the runoff based on the cross-sectional area of the runway and roads. And drains with the trapezoidal section are considered, and then the slope of the drain bed, and then we calculate the discharge. So this is the calculation with slopes on the sides. Side slopes for trapezoidal is 1:2, and rectangle is 1:1. And the coefficient of roughness should be considered, and this is the formula for velocity of runoff at each grid by Manning's formula, you know. So this is the 1 by n, m to the power of 0.67, and s to the power of 0.5, or s 1 by 2, 2 by 3 and 1 by 2. So this is the quantity of runoff discharge area into velocity. So we calculate the velocity by Manning's formula, and self-cleaning velocity of any drain is, that means to prevent the sedimentation. So 0.7 meters per second velocity, and quantity of runoff should be more than P1. So this is the discharge, designing the section of the drain, and a calculation of rainfall intensity with time concentration and return period. So we have four methods, as I said. We have our land flow, and this is the one method in which you get 124 millimeters per hour time of rainfall intensity. And method B, we calculate and you get 75. Method C, and method B is 78, and we take the highest. Method C is 75, and method D is again calculated to get the rainfall intensity of 37. So we take the highest for stormwater discharge calculations and design the stormwater. So this is the different cross-sectional areas, and formula constants we take, and coefficient of runoff, as I have shown, we'll take, and intensity of rainfall we take, and area of drainage we take and design for the runoff. So these are the discharges as per rainfall and class of areas, and these are the cross section of the drains which we design, and then discharge as per the cross sectional area of the drain we design. So finally we prepare the layouts, and here this is one interesting example I wanted to share with you in water conservation. This is a GVK mall, you know, the cross section. We have studied the slope of the site, and we were briefed by the client that they want to construct five parking levels below the ground. So the excavation was starting from 22 meters here to 15 meters here, almost like. So there is a slope and all that. So we realized that when you are excavating 20 meter deep, you are as well making a well. So in olden days, we used to get the water in the well, and the ground is sloping like this towards the Hussain Sagar Lake, the site contour. So we have proposed collection of rain water, because even the rainwater we can collect, and also the second seepage water we can, underground subsoil water we can collect. So we designed the invert sand filters in the backfill of the retaining wall, and we have estimated 6 lakh liters water collection every day, and we designed an underground sump for 6 lakh liters capacity. And you know, the whole construction was done without buying water, with this collected water only. And now also the we have the water, and excess water is used for the hotels owned by the same owner. So this is the design a civil engineer can do. And we have to also design the stormwater drainage in the lowermost basement. So we have given those inputs, and we did not design for water pressure. We instead allowed the water to seep into the basement, and we provided the drains for collection, and then we collected that water also. So it don't prevent water entering. You allow the water to enter, collect the water, and manage it. So give a honorary exit for the water and use it. Yeah, there will be some contamination in any water. We have to collect the samples of the water and propose the treatment for that water. And so this is the plan layout of the stormwater drains. And this is another cross section. You have to study the cross section always of the ground and the building, and plan the water collection. Here you can see the basement, and what is the lowest level in the site, and what is the height of basement, and design these stormwater drains. And these are the manholes to be used for the stormwater, and then we have to design these percolation pits and collection of water into the drain, and train the water. And this is the pipe, puddle flange pipe, for collection of water from outside the retaining wall into the lowermost basement. So we collect the water. So this is again water collection in the retaining walls that we design, and we provide the drains with the perforated gratings. So this is the stormwater drain layout. We design this area, for example, what is the runoff for the here in the area that we designed this drain is about 200 mm rainfall, 2000 mm rainfall per annum. Very high rainfall area, and we designed this box culvert with perforated covers. So this is the stormwater typical drain detail. So much detailing is required. Please note for the stormwater and collect the water and then run it off with the slopes required and all that. And this is a rectangular stormwater drain. When the capacities are low, we can design this rectangular water drain so that you can reduce the width and cover this rectangular drain. And these are the box culverts below the roads which we have to design for the stormwater again discharge. And this is the layout of the total runway which we have done around. And the buildings also, we do this, we have these roads and then collect the water into the side stormwater and train this stormwater. And this is a street with the median. Then you have the camber on two directions and you have the stormwater drains on both the sides. And this is a typical residential community layout where we plan. Almost we have done projects. Every project we design this proper stormwater drainage system along with the roads and the box culverts, and these are the details furnished in those projects. So next topic is the flooding. So we all are aware of the flooding issues. These are typical photographs of the flooding, and excess water flows will cause the flooding. And flooding happens when your stormwater drainage system is not adequately provisioned for the peak rainfalls. That means if you change the usage pattern of the land, also the flooding is caused. And so flash floods, you have fluvial floods, multiple event floods, seasonal floods, coastal floods, estuarine floods, and urban floods. So these are the flash floods. Suddenly there will be breach of the embankment, and this kind of flash floods happen. And we have seen the biggest flash flood in Chardam actually. And fluvial riverine floods, that means if you construct the houses in the river buffer zones, this is what will happen. And single event floods, and then we have multiple event floods, that means we design the road itself for the stormwater, and this kind of flooding happens. And seasonal floods happen due to excess rainfall, the normal lands also. And coastal storm, you know the storms that happen, and we have to, why I'm showing all this is, as a civil engineer, when we are designing Kedarnath, how human encroachment, mainly the Kedarnath, the cause is the human encroachment and erosion, soil erosion that happened over periods, and there was a cloud burst. It is not just the human alone. The Kedarnath flood happened because of the cloud burst primarily, and also added to that is the, because people have encroached the river region, constructed the buildings, so they have caused the erosion of the soil, and then it has worsened the situation. They have covered the channel area. That is why it happened. Coastal storm floods and estuarine river joining the sea. You know, the we have every river joining the sea, and due to flood in the river, the sea area near that, estuarine floods are caused. And these are the urban floods, because we block the stormwater drains, and this is the urban floods that are caused. And the snow melt floods, the sudden snow melting happens in summer times, and then it happens. And ice and debris jam floods. So this also will cause. And the effect of floods is physical damage, disruption of essential services, we all know. And the long-term effect, and the flood-prone areas in India, we all know, West Bengal, Assam, because of Brahmaputra, Assam, China, whenever they have excess water, they will be suddenly releasing through Brahmaputra, and Bihar, Uttar Pradesh, and Orissa. These are the main states causing major flooding actually, and other states all together contribute to 43%. So this is a report. We have done the internship, summer internship in 2017 done by some students. It's really a good report submitted by the students. I just want to run the objective of this study. Students have done, and we wanted to submit to the government of Telangana and GHMC on the causes of flooding in Hyderabad and flood management that can be done. What they have done is we have studied the all the lakes, what is their actual capacity and what is their present capacity, and what is the excess water that is causing the flooding in Hyderabad. So this is the report. If anybody is interested, so they have studied the lakes, different lakes of Hyderabad, and then they have studied various outlets of these stormwater nalas and all that. And then this is the calculation of runoff discharge, and they have used this formula, unit hydrograph, for calculating the runoff. And this is the formulas they have used. And they have studied the catchment areas of each of the lake by studying through Google and topo sheets. They have identified the catchment of each lake. And then these are the drainage channels they have studied, and infiltration and all that. So this is the disaster management guidelines also they have considered, and causes of flooding and all that. I really appreciate, I still remember a student, Vaishnavi, who was a student from IIIT, who has made an excellent report. In fact, I sent an email to her when I'm making this presentation. So these are all the each lake. Yeah, this I'll just share with you. Each lake, we have calculated the catchment area, and then we have calculated the elevation of the lake and depth of the lake, capacity of the lake, and discharge in cubic meters and runoff discharge in cubic meters. So this is the cubic meters per second, that is the discharge actually. And the overall runoff from the lake also we have calculated. Like this, they have calculated all the lakes. So even students can do this much of work within 6 weeks. They did this work, and tell me about all anybody engineering company doing the project. This as a project. So this is the total. This is the runoff of another lake, like 75 lakes so far. I have shown you here, and this is the 90 lakes. So Hussain Sagar sample calculation is shown here, and so this is the monthly runoff. Rainfall and runoff, we are all aware, August is the peak in Hyderabad for the rainfall, and then September. So you can see the total runoff that is calculated. So total monsoon runoff into catchment area is this much discharge for one lake. So this is the flood. So we have identified what is the number of lakes. So you can see in this map, they have drawn for each lake catchment area. For example, this lake. So this is the catchment area of the lake actually. So you can see every lake they have identified the catchment areas, and they have calculated the runoff. This is a manually drawn map actually, you can see. And these are the Hussain Sagar, Usman Sagar, and Hussain Sagar, Himayat Sagar, and Usman Sagar. So these are the Hyderabad lakes, sorry. So this is the map from which they have calculated the discharges. So you can estimate the flooding for the city. So here you can see 450 meters is the level. Like this, for every lake, they have identified the highest level, lowest level, depth of the tank, and calculated the discharge. So summary of the report. So like this, we have done summer internships. Still, it is a possible for every city. You can do internships with the students. One of the consultant in each city can take up this, and then we'll be offering solution to the people. Like this, we offer traffic problem solutions and house building health checkup solutions like that. So you can discuss with me if you want to do this in your city, every town, and flood management can be done. And these are the flood management engineering solutions, embankments, dams and reservoirs, channel improvement, drainage improvement, and diversion of the floods. And flood preparedness, okay, if the flood is unavoidable, Then these are the flood preparedness and data collection and data transmission and data analysis and estimated rain forwarded speed and flood management. So this is the flood forecasting network. We have to have the rain gauges installed in all the catchments and identify the rainfall and forewarn the flood. Yeah, because the runoff will take certain time for every flood. So these are Sacramento River model is the worldwide accepted river model. And so this is the flood forecasting system. So recharges, although flood is the most deadliest disaster still, in spite of all engineering and all, it has some indirect benefits like recharging of the groundwater, freshwater flood helps in maintaining floodplain ecosystem and boost in flood production for birds and food production and the facilitation of weather fish. And finally, conclusion is we have to have dams and hold back floodwaters, reservoirs, store floodwater, and straighten channels, increase the speed of flow. And dredging makes, speed of flow is important to reduce the flood. And dredging makes channels deeper so it can hold more water. And land use zoning restricts development, buffer zones and all that. And then we have increased interception, etc., and reduces runoff and leaves, levees and embankments prevent river from overflowing. So in Telangana, I keep studying this government action. Like Haritaharam will increase afforestation and reduce the increase the interception actually, Haritaharam. And Mission Kaktiya, dredging is being done to increase the water holding and reduce the flood. And Mission Bhagiratha is to supply the water to villages, all the rural areas. And irrigation projects also build the dams and hold the water and reduce the flooding. And the city water supply from Krishna and Godavari is being done, but is it really required? That's my big question. So with this, I'll conclude. I have taken 2 minutes, 3 minutes more because I had a phone call before. So thank you very much. Now, if you have any questions, 2-3 minutes, I can take questions. Kedarnath, I explained, definitely it is partly man-made and partly natural because of the cloudburst and sudden rain water runoff. STP treated water can be used for lawn and flushing. Yes, we have been using, and this is one of the requirements of pollution control, no objection certificate. Stormwater runoff and calculation is the job of civil engineers. Actually, we design these stormwater systems for every project. So, there are no, I think there are no questions here in Facebook. Stormwater drain should be covered or open? It depends actually. If you have the land usage above the stormwater, you have to cover it like driveway. You can use it as a driveway. And how to check flooding while selecting the site? Yeah, that's very important question, Sanjay NASA. Because you have to study the Google map and you have to collect the data of the nearest lake about its FTL, full tank level, you know. So then you should not construct any building within that FTL area. There is a rule, but people keep violating. Can we completely desalinate the water? Or any limitation? No, yes, it can be brought to the potable level. Desalination is done in Middle East very widely, and now in India, Tata group company has come up with a desalination plant, and cost of desalination is only 0.6 60 paise per liter, I think. Some in situations due to vastu problems, it is not possible to provide harvesting. Harvesting, yeah, I don't know, Vastu should help plan properly for the sustainability actually. Hemant Kumar, yeah. And if there are no other questions, I will conclude here and I will stop live stream. Thank you very much. Have a good day. Meet you tomorrow at 7:30. Bye.